Cool. Well, okay, guys, give it up for Oskar.
Yeah, I guess I can start. Thank you all for coming. So my name is Oskar. I work as a developer here in Belgrade in a precision medicine field. So the idea behind today's talk is to go over swarm intelligence. It's a subset of artificial intelligence that takes inspiration from different phenomenons in the nature, because the nature is the ultimate source of intelligence, the ultimate problem solver over the last 4 billion years. So it only makes sense to model software based on that. So just to give you a brief rundown, where does the swarm intelligence field gets into the inside the AI umbrella. So when people think about AI these days, we are mostly talking about deep learning, machine learning, because of the explosive success of ChatGPT and things like that. That's all artificial neural networks, deep learning, where you model your software via the way how real neural networks work in the human brain. And another large subset of artificial intelligence is based on biologically inspired algorithms, where you model software based on different phenomena in nature. There are largely two large groups. One of them are evolutionary algorithms, based on the work of theory of evolution, Charles Darwin, survival of the fittest. And the another large group is swarm intelligence. So we'll have some math, some math equations. There is no AI without math. But the math here is very manageable compared to what we would have with deep learning or with evolutionary algorithms. I've chosen swarm intelligence because you would all be able to follow. There are many different swarm intelligence algorithms, but we will take a look specifically at the ant colony optimization. It's a intelligent software that bases its behavior on the way that ant colonies work in nature. All right, so swarm intelligence in nature is the ability of life forms to gain amazing capabilities when they are grouped into hives, swarms, colonies. So you can imagine individual agents having some level of intelligence, some level of interesting abilities, but when you group them together, they achieve another level of intelligence, something that is way beyond that any separate agent can only dream of, right? And in nature, we observe that in beehives, in flock of birds, and in the colonies of ants. So why have I, out of all of those, I have chosen ants. So why? So ants have some very interesting abilities. Ants are very fast. In 1 minute, a single ant can pass 700 times its body length. It's like humans being able to run 65 kilometers an hour. Other than that, ants are really strong. Every average ant can lift more than 10 times its body weight. With some species being able to lift 50 times. So if you imagine a human world where humans could run 70 kilometers an hour, lift 5,000 kilograms, it would be like a completely different world. And that is reality for ants, as even separate entities, let alone colonies. And another big thing for ants is diversity. Despite the name Antarctic, Antarctic is the only place without ants on Earth. Every other continent on Earth has ants. There are over 15,000 different species of ants. So if you want to observe ants, their intelligent behavior, based your software on that, you don't have to look further than your backyard, wherever you live on the planet. So these are separate ants, but combined into colonies, they form something that in biology people call the superorganisms. So it's the ability of massive amounts of agents to act as a single entity, to have a brain of its own. And ants are able to achieve that because they have a very sophisticated way of communicating. When they walk around, they leave something called pheromones, which is simply said chemical trails that they can let other ants know, hey, I've already been here, and this is the right path if you want to find food, or this is the wrong path because it leads to danger, or it leads to wasteland, absolutely nothing. So if you have enough ants running around, they will all mark different territories, and then all the new ants coming up will know which roads to take without doing much thinking. And when enough time, enough cycle comes, the ants will reach something that's in mathematics called convergence. And convergence is the ability in a graph of infinite possibilities to find the optimal solution in finite amount of time. And that's for software, that's very good thing. And we'll see exactly how that is implemented in an example, right? So for just for the colony size, there's some interesting things I wanted to say. An average colony that you might see walking around in the park would have 20,000 ants, and that's comparable with the agents and software that you might create. But there are also something that's called super colonies in nature. And the largest one is actually in Europe. It goes across Italy, Spain, France, and Portugal, a single ant colony with hundreds of millions of ants that covers 6,000 kilometers. That's the largest known superorganism, the largest known ant colony. All right, so how we do, why is that so interesting in terms of software? So we can take those amazing abilities of ant colony, the pheromone system, the convergence, and we can use that to solve some of the unsolvable problems in the computer science. So what's the number one most famous MP-hard problem in computer science? It's likely traveling salesman. You have a graph of different nodes, and you want to visit every node only once, but you want to do that in an optimal way, right? So there are many different variations on the problem, but this is the simplest one. And if you look at the some capabilities that ant colonies have, they are arguably perfect to solve that problem for us. So you can imagine if you, in an hour or so when you want to go home, you might go in Google Maps and you might want to see the route back to your apartment. Well, Google will have to give you an approximate solution based on the convergence. If they give you a brute force solution, it will take hours or years. We'll see exact numbers in one of the following slides. So this is going to be our example today. We have a graph of six nodes. It's kind of a Disneyland theme, and you have six different rides, and you want to drive every ride and then go home, right? So you don't know where to start, you don't know where to end. You just know that you want to visit every node exactly once. So for six nodes, it turns out that the number of possibilities is always n minus 1 factorial divided by 2. And that comes down to, for six, that's 5 factorial 120 divided by 260. So you have 60 different possibilities for this graph. It's something that you can do manually on hand. You can, your PC can easily handle 60 different calculations and then finding a minimum. But if we bump that up just slightly, let's say you have 20 different nodes. On a commodity hardware, on a laptop like this one, MacBook Air M2, it would take around 600 years to calculate all the possibilities. And if you create an ant colony with the population of 50 ants, let them walk around your graph and find a solution for you, they can do that in a split second, sub 0.05 seconds. They can find over 99% optimal solution. So solving this graph by hand, it turns out the minimal distance is 23. But again, this is only possible because this is a very small graph. And even if the graph is small, this is not something you ever want to do by hand. Okay. So as you have seen in this slide, we have distances between the edges. And that's the first factor that we're going to take into our algorithm. And that's the first factor that's going to be in our math equation. The other factor is that communication system called pheromones. And those are actually the only two factors. That's why the math is simple here. You have two factors, and if you have two factors, there's no way to have some amazingly complicated math behind it. So at the beginning, we'll set all the pheromones to exactly the same number because we don't want any bias. So this every edge has its distance and it has its pheromones. I've set pheromones to one for kind of a specific reason. Pheromones never stick around indefinitely. They evaporate over time. It doesn't make sense to leave a chemical trail and then to find that trail 100 years after, because you always want to reinforce the best path, meaning depositing new pheromones on better paths, and you want to discourage the suboptimal paths. And you do that by evaporating old pheromones and always depositing new pheromones on the optimal path that you find. So I have all pheromones set to one, because I'm doing evaporation by, let's say, every tick, I want to evaporate 10% of pheromones. So if I have number over zero, I can just multiply that number by 0.9. And that way I can evaporate 10%. If these were all zeros, you can still do evaporation, but it complicates math a little bit. So we only care that we have zero bias. We don't care about the exact number. It can be one or 1,000 or 1,000,000. So our first step is to create the ant population. Again, this is another parameter that you will use to tune your model. So you have six nodes. Based on that information, you will choose how large or small your ant colony would be. So I have chosen to have five ants. Five ants to find a solution, or five software agents, virtual ants, to find a solution for a six-node graph. In the example I gave you a few minutes ago, that a 20-node graph would take 600 years to do brute force, and it would take a split second to do with ant colony. I was talking about population of 50 ants. So 20 nodes, 50 ants, and I decided for 6 nodes to choose 5 ants. But that is something that you tune. You have to do trial and error to tune your model and see what works best for your graph and distances between the nodes. So we have 5 ants, and the next step is simple, it's natural. Every ant needs to choose where to move next. And where to move next is always chosen by doing math. So we have a math formula that only has two factors, pheromones and distance. We'll do something with that and calculate probabilities. But before we do that, there is something very important in nature and also in software. We need to infuse something called stochastic nature, or a bit of randomness. We need to ensure that, let's say, 1 in 10 ants will say, hey, I hate math, I don't want to do equations, I just did the Ferris wheel, I like balloons, I want to take a balloon ride. And it will disregard all the math and run straight to do the balloons. And that's very important because you want to fight local maximums and minimums, because sometimes they're not in line with globally best solutions. If you were always only looking at local heuristics, you will always find locally best paths. But if they are not in line with globally best solutions, you will never actually escape that trap of locally finding good solutions, but globally never converging. So you need a randomness, stochastic nature, that will help you to actually break out. And if just enough ants randomly stumble upon a globally best path, the pheromone system will help you that all the other ants would start actually skipping locally best solution and converge to use the globally best solutions. So choosing the next move, 1 in 10 ants will do it randomly. 9 out of 10 will have to do the math. The math is very simple. I have a formula here, but it might be even simpler looking at the example. All we have to do is divide our amount of pheromones with our distance between the two edges. So let me show you an example. So you have an ant sitting around in the circus. It needs to decide where to move next. If we evaluate the Ferris wheel, pheromones is 11, distance is 4. All we want to do is divide those two numbers. But you might see that I have these powers, one or two. These are additional parameters that you will use to tune your model, and they are weights. They will simply help you to give more value to one heuristic over the other. You might say, for my use case, I value distance way more than I value pheromones, meaning I value what every separate agent knows way more than I value what the whole system, what the whole colony knows. And that is what I did in this example. I said, my distance has a weight of 2, and my pheromones has a weight of 1, meaning I value just a bit more the shortest distance over the pheromones. But again, these are third and fourth parameters that you would tune based on your input graph, on your input data set. So we did that for Ferris wheel. Now we do exactly the same equation for all the other nodes. And these are the numbers, from 0.68, and the balloons have the least probability 0.07. And for computers, these numbers above, they are enough. But for us humans, we like to see percentages. So we scale them down between 0 and 1, just so it's a bit easier for us humans. So Ferris wheel, when it scales down, it's 0.39, meaning you have a 39 percentage probability of choosing that as your next node. And now you might say, all right, this is the highest probability. This is the node that I will choose. But that's not really what we'll do. We will again introduce that stochastic nature by introducing something that's called the roulette wheel. We will create a roulette wheel that's really a pie chart, and we'll divide that pie chart based on all the probabilities we calculated. We will spin the wheel, and wherever the wheel stops, we will decide this is where I want to move. So it's in nature, it's random. But our probabilities are actually affecting our randomness in a sense that we are using locally best paths, but then we have this randomness that again help us to not choose the local best paths that are not convergent with globally best paths. So we have actually two different points in our algorithm where we introduce the randomness to help us fight setting ourselves into a trap of always choosing locally best solutions and never finding the globally best ones. All right, so all the ants have chosen where to move next. Some of them were lucky. They skipped all the equation, the roulette wheel system. 9 out of 10 had to do the math, and they've chosen their destination that way. So what do you do next? We need to update our pheromone trail. So we had 6 nodes, so every ant had to do 5 different decisions where to move next. When it makes those decisions, we need to deposit new pheromones. And we deposit pheromones based on how good the solution we have found is. If the solution is bad, if it's worse than what we have found before, then we might deposit a small amount of pheromones or 0 pheromones. If the solution is great, then we'll deposit large amount of pheromones. And then every new ant, every new software agent that comes across that road will know, all right, this path has massive amounts of pheromones, means it's optimal, good path. There is a source of food in this direction. Or if there is a subpar amount of pheromones, it will know, all right, I'm likely not going to take this path because the source of food is either depleted or is a danger there or the food was never there. So you update pheromone trails. And you do that how many times? That's the most important question. So you have after every iteration, you have found some solution. But you need to decide where to stop. Because if you never stop, you're getting brute force approach. Every single iteration, you're getting better and better results. But it doesn't matter if it takes too long, if it takes hours or even minutes. You want to find an optimal solution in a split second, ideally with software. So deciding when to stop your analysis and take, all right, this is 99% the correct solution. I'm happy with this, and I'm going to go with this. So your stopping criteria, you have 2 options. First one is purely cost-based. You can say, all right, I have $20 budget. I'm going to buy the cheapest EC2 instance on Amazon. I'm going to run my analysis until I'm out of credits. And whenever I'm out, I'm going to take this as my solution. It's likely going to be good. Or you can even up the intelligence of your software a bit more and not use that predefined number of iterations, but you can actually follow closely what your result is after every iteration, and you can wait until your results starts to stagnate, meaning for hundreds of thousands of different iterations, you're getting the same result, or your result is marginally improving. That's a pretty strong indication for you that, hey, this is good enough, and this is especially good enough cross-reference with the amount of resources I spent. So I'm happy with this, and I will stop doing my analysis. So stopping criteria is actually the final step in your algorithm. So tweaking the model. We mentioned many different parameters to tweak. The first one is pure randomness. It's that case where your agent will say, I'm not going to do any math, and we'll just randomly choose my next destination. You have weights, and we only have two weights for pheromones and weights for distance. Our heuristic is distance. And in our case, those were one and two. But depending on your input data set, you might have way more weights for way many more factors, because maybe only distance doesn't matter that much to you. Maybe you have cost. Maybe different traveling between different edges has different cost in other resources other than time. So if your input set is more complex, you'll have more factors. Everything else will be the same, but your math equation will be a bit more complex, and you'll have more parameters to tinker and to try out until you find the best mix. The other one was size of the colony. So some production grade system would either have from 0.5 to 5. So if you have, let's say, 10, 10 is a small number, but if you have a 10 node graph, you will either have 5 agents, or you have 50 agents. You can have hundreds of thousands of agents, and you will find a great result, but that will require massive amounts of resources. And ant colony optimization, as any other optimization algorithm, is all about finding the best solution, but using the absolute least amount of resources, right? And the number of iterations to complete, that's if you decide to have a somewhat dumb end of your algorithm by having a predefined number of cost or iterations. That's a parameter to tweak. And the last one is how fast are you evaporating pheromones. And this is something that's interesting in academic literature, because in nature, pheromone evaporation is very important, but it's number 3, 4, 5. In software, evaporating pheromones turns out to be the absolute number one parameter to tinker with. Because ant colony optimization is mathematically proven to have a convergence, again, meaning that in optimal, you will find an optimal solution in finite amount of time. But the most important thing is speed of convergence. How fast can you find that optimal solution? And that speed is dependent on all of these parameters, and only on these parameters. So you need to tinker with them to reduce the time, to up the speed. And the factor that seems to have by far the largest value in tinkering with is the pheromone evaporation factor, at least in software, not as much in nature, right? So just to summarize all the steps, initially, you want to set up your pheromones in your graph to have the same value. You want to have zero bias between different paths. You want to set up your colony of ants, set up your ant population, and then you want to let them run around your graph. They'll choose their next node either by doing the math and calculating probabilities, or by just randomly running around. That will help you fight that discrepancy with globally best and locally best solutions. And then you do that long enough until you're happy with your solution. Either you have run out of money, or you're really happy with your solution. And then at the end, you'll just return whatever you found to be the best one. So how is this actually used in the real world? Some real world applications. One of the larger ones is supply chain networks. So whatever you can, and these are all generated by AI, by a different type of AI. It's Adobe's Stable Diffusion model. We mentioned ChatGPT that predicts the next sequence of text. This is a similar architecture, but it just predicts next pixel in an image. But this is more of an ML. And column optimization is likely a pure AI, but different people put that in different categories. Supply chain networks, you have massive graphs where you have on one end, you have packages, warehouses, and on the other end, you have customers. And you have many different types of nodes between them. Some of them are planes, cars, ships, governments, police, and you need to find an optimal route between them to get every package to every customer. That's mathematically impossible to do in brute force. You need an optimization algorithm. So what's used around the world in things like FedEx or similar is mostly a software called IBM Simplex. By the name, you might guess that that's implementation of simplex principle from linear math, linear algebra, linear programming. Comparing that to something like ant colony, but granted, simplex is mostly used in production, and ant colony is used a lot in academia, but still comparing results with the same data set, with ant colony optimization, you can get 99% same results with 50% less resources. And with massive supply chain networks, that's very important. Another thing about supply chain is that something unexpected can always happen, like COVID. COVID can happen, and it can kill half the nodes in your network. What's interesting about the ant colony is that ant colony can run in real time. And in real time, you can kill nodes and add new nodes, and they will. It's the same as in the nature. When they found a food source, it's not going to be there forever. They're going to eat all the food, and then that node dies. So you can do the same thing in software. So in real time, you can optimize your supply chain. And that's very valuable for real-world supply chain. Some other uses that are interesting is vehicle routing problem. This is what Google does a lot. They have a bunch of white papers on this topic. They're self-driving cars, Waymo. They have many different cars and many different customers, rides, destinations, starting and end points. And they need to optimize the graph so that every car knows when and how to pick up every customer and where to leave that customer off. And this is a more complex example of traveling salesman. So if you dumb this down, you have one car, one destination, you get a traveling salesman. In the real world, things are often more complex. You have many different starting points, many different ending points. But still, the principles of the algorithms are still the same. Another pretty interesting from the aerospace usage of the ant colony is something called multi-satellite control resource scheduling. So satellites, they have that interesting thing that their resources are floating around in space. So every bit of hardware there is worth its weight in gold, and you need to do heavy reuse. That means that all the different satellites needs to find an optimal route in every moment in time, how to reuse the resources, which of all are shared across them. So this is also where something like ant colony has found the usage in real time. Some other things are image edge detection. You can likely imagine having ants running around pixels in the image and outlining different objects, finding a different object in the image. Something that's used in Wall Street is bankers would use ant colony optimization to figure out if the company would go bankrupt. What is the optimal decision graph of decisions to take so the company goes or not go bankrupt, probably depending if they have a long or short position in that company. And protein folding. You likely know all about protein folding, about Google's AlphaFold project that mapped all mapped proteins. All of those problems are actually optimization problems with massive decision graphs, and that's why ant colony optimization can be directly applied to all of them. So at the end, I just want to share some references, because many of the examples I've took, many of the pictures, images are from these references. The first one is a book, and it's actually like introductory book to like pure AI algorithms, evolutionary algorithms, genetic algorithms, swarm intelligence, and then the second part of the book is ML. So if you're looking for some introductory thing, the first book is pretty nice. But all the others, they are way higher level. There are PhDs and white papers of different usages of ant colony around the world. Right, the first one being from the 90s, this is the first PhD that introduced this algorithm to the world. Yeah, we have a few minutes left, but this is all I wanted to cover, so I guess thank you for your time. Yeah, if anyone has some questions, you can either ask now, you can find me later, today or tomorrow. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
What is the best strategy to use for parameter tuning for this ant colony optimization algorithm for the parameters? Colony size, pheromone evaporation, and the weight parameters. Do we have some strategy that we can employ to select the best parameters?
Yeah. So let's say if you follow ML closely, you will see that they always use the word state of the art. So it's pretty similar here. You have some state of the art values that are known to be applicable to every data set. So it's 10% evaporation rate. It's between 0.9 and 2.5 for the colony size. So you have best practice parameters. But to actually get the very best solutions, you need to do the trial and error tuning. You need to run your analysis many times and see what works best for your data set. Granted, the data set doesn't change much. If you change your data set all the time, then you're likely going to see the best results by just using what's considered state of the art.
For example, it's best to use those values as a starting point and try around those values.
Yeah, I'll say that makes sense to me as well. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you again for listening. Then. Mm-hmm.